Dry 3D printing filament can be essential for mechanically strong, but also visually appealing parts. I recently bought myself a vacuum chamber that can easily boil water after a minute of evacuation. I thought this might be a great way to dry filament, without the need for heating and potentially damaging the polymer. To see if it really worked, I investigated different drying methods a little closer. I compared vacuum drying against a normal food dehydrator and also a circulation oven at even higher temperatures to see how much moisture they can remove and how long you really need to dry your materials. I also tested how filament behaved in a box full of desiccant. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. This video is sponsored in part by Audible, and I have a really cool audiobook recommendation for you at the end. So I recently bought myself a vacuum chamber that I want to use for degassing resin and vacuum casting. I thought this might also be a great new method to dry my filaments without harming them by high temperatures. Well, turns out it unfortunately isn't that simple, and I'll show you why in a bit. Usually, we distinguish between surface and core moisture. You can get surface moisture if you, for example, get a roll of filament out of your air-conditioned house into your garage on a humid day. Moisture condenses on the material and causes problems, even with non-hydroscopic materials. This moisture, if it's not soaked up by the material, will quickly evaporate in normal ambient air and cause no long-term problems. Core moisture, on the other hand, is moisture that is in the material itself, and that's what we're usually concerned about, because to get rid of it, it needs to diffuse to the outside and then evaporate there. We assist evaporation usually by heating air, which reduces the relative humidity of it. We can only dry until we reach a moisture equilibrium between the drying medium and the moist medium, which is the reason why warmed up and therefore drier air can remove more moisture than cooler air. The dew point of the air characterizes this. The lower, the drier, and the better it is suited for drying. Higher temperatures probably also increase the diffusion speed to transport the moisture from the inside to the outside of the material. A vacuum reduces the boiling point of the water and might, therefore, help when trying to reduce the moisture content because it's easier for the moisture to get out of the material. In industrial injection molding, it's totally common that the plastic pellets are dried before they enter the process. Dry material is essential to ensure process stability, appearance, and mechanical properties of the product. In our 3D printers, we also melt the plastic, and moisture in the material is a factor that can often decide whether your print is successful or not. Many overlook that factor because at first glance, common materials like PLA, PETG, and ABS don't seem to be affected that much. More technical materials like nylon or others behave way differently when not properly conditioned and will bubble up, string, and just break apart after printing. But also our common materials are affected by water that is contained within the material. Moist or just not ideally dry material strings more, oozes more, and in the case of PETG for example, can lead to severe hydrolysis where the water in the material causes the long polymer chains to break up, which causes the material to become brittle. How do you usually store your materials, and what effects have you already seen when you didn't condition your materials properly? Let us know and leave a comment down below. I also store many of my materials simply on a filament rack, which works okay most of the time. I only store my really hygroscopic materials in a plastic box with a ton of desiccant on the inside to keep it dry, since even short exposure to normal outside humidity can cause moisture pickup and degrade the material during the process. I even have one box out of which I can directly print. If you also want to build one on your own, then check out the video I made about it. A couple of months ago, I bought myself one of these generic single-stage vacuum pumps on Amazon with a large pot-like container and an acrylic lid. Not the cheapest, but definitely also not the most professional one, but probably well suitable for degassing resin and some vacuum casting that I would like to do in the future. One of the things I just had to do at first was to get a cup of cold water to boil, and it's able to do that in around a minute. Great! So the idea was that if I can get water to boil at room temperatures, can I also get the moisture in filament to boil out without the need to heat it? A food dehydrator or your kitchen oven work for that process as well. But not only do they both consume considerable amounts of energy, the heat can also damage the filament itself. Obviously, if you overheat the material, for example, above the glass transition temperature, it can become soft and deform on the roll. Or, as some others have already experienced in the past, you can even melt the roll that it's spooled on. Even though you might have selected the right temperature, you can still damage the material and overdry it. This means that the additives that, for example, make the material less brittle can be damaged at longer heat exposure times, or the polymer can even oxidize. When that happens is hard to say and depends on the material and manufacturer, but the less exposure to heat the materials have, the better. So let's get to the tests, and if you like my video and learn something, make sure to subscribe and activate the notification bell. I loaded the container with a roll of PLA, TPU, ASA and ABS filament, ran the vacuum pump for 15 minutes, and then shut all of the valves and let it sit. I wasn't able to run the pump for longer, because it would otherwise overheat. So, after 15 minutes, the vacuum limit for my setup was reached, and the dial didn't move anymore. I regularly removed the vacuum, weighed the material on a sufficiently precise scale that I calibrated before each use to mitigate temperature drift. At first, I measured in shorter intervals. Later, they got longer, and altogether, I performed regular measurements for 10 days. Looking at the results, we can nicely see that at first, we remove a higher amount of moisture from the material as after a while. At around the 5-day mark sitting in the chamber with regular evacuation, the weight stagnates, and we don't remove any significant amount of moisture anymore. I plotted the results in two different ways. Once, just the weight itself, but depending on the initial weight of the material, 1 gram of moisture can be significant or also not. The second plot shows the moisture change rate in percent and nicely shows when nothing is happening anymore. Even though we removed 1 to 2 grams of moisture for every roll, this is still only a reduction by around 0.1 to 0.2%, which isn't a lot. Out of curiosity, I also printed a pair of 3D benches from PETG. Still, I couldn't really see any significant difference in the print quality, which poses the question if the vacuum was able to remove all of the moisture or only some. So I left the materials outside to rehydrate and also weighed the materials regularly. Interestingly, the moisture uptake is again high at first and then slows down until it gets to a more or less constant level after 5 days. Almost all of the moisture we removed during the vacuum drying seems to be back in the material, which shows that if you want to keep your material dry, you also need to store it properly. Next, I wanted to compare vacuum drying to heat drying in a food dehydrator that I've been using in the past to condition my materials. This test should give us an indication of how long this method takes to dry filament, and if it can remove more moisture in comparison to vacuum. I stacked the material in a way that ASA was on the bottom and PLA was on the top, so that I could raise the temperature a little more, because the heat comes out of the bottom. With a setting of 75 degrees Celsius, I get 65 degrees Celsius for the ASA and around 55 degrees Celsius for the PLA, which reduces the risk to soften the material, but to be high enough to dry them properly. As a rule of thumb, stay at least a couple of degrees below the glass transition temperatures of the material you treat. You can usually find that value in the technical data sheets. I newly added a carbon fiber nylon because that should be especially critical for the moisture, and this roll has been sitting in my office unprotected for a year now. We again see that at first the amount of moisture that is removed is high and slowly decreases and stabilizes. After 12 hours, there is barely any change anymore. In the past, I usually let it run overnight, so this test now confirms my usual procedure. Still, if you really want to know how long you need to dry your specific materials with your setup, I'd strongly recommend getting a decently precise scale. During drying, weigh the rolls from time to time until there's barely any change anymore measurable. Comparing the two methods shows that heat drying is not only the quicker way of drying, but also it removes more moisture in total. So I'd say that at least with one of these generic single-stage vacuum pumps, vacuum drying is not as efficient as drying using warm and dry air. Maybe combining vacuum and medium heat might yield better results, though I wasn't able to try that yet. What I did try was vacuum drying and storing a couple of materials in a chamber with additional desiccant. The silica gel took up quite some moisture, which also reduces the increase in pressure caused by the evaporating water. This circumstance probably helped to get a bit more moisture out of the materials, though it still wasn't as effective as heat drying. At the current point, I'd suggest using this method for storing demanding materials, but not for the initial drying. Next, I wanted to work on the question if the filament spools are dried more on the outside than on the inside due to the lack of airflow, especially with these perfect winding spools. For this reason, I stored the dried spools of material in one of my dry boxes and under vacuum for a week. The idea was that after a while, the moisture might equalize again within the spool. I then dried it in the food dehydrator for a second time. The interesting thing that I was able to see was that some materials seemed to pick up and some seemed to lose a small amount of weight while being stored. This might be moisture from the atmosphere within the drying container or just the pickup during the time I had them in ambient air while weighing. Even though noticeable, the change is around one order of magnitude lower than what we lost during the initial drying. The drying step after storing again removes only a tiny amount of weight from the rolls. For ASA, PLA and PETG, only in the range of what we have gained during storing. Only the CF nylon lost a more significant amount again. Since this spool was very loosely wound, I don't think that it was due to the unequal drying in the first run, but this probably shows that more demanding or more hygroscopic materials might require more conditioning than others. Since the other spools only lost a tiny amount of moisture, I think we can assume that drying in a food dehydrator for around half a day equally removes moisture from the whole spool and not only the outer layers. Even just 4 to 6 hours usually does the trick for PLA and PETG. Out of curiosity, I also threw two rolls of undried PLA and PETG in the silica-filled dry box, and those lost quite a significant amount of moisture during the week. Additionally, drying in my food dehydrator only removes a little more, so a properly sealed box with plenty of silica in it, which I, for example, buy by the kilo in buckets, might already be a good start to keep the less demanding filaments in a good state. Due to health concerns, I don't recommend desiccant with indicator anymore, and rather suggest you put a hygrometer in there. As soon as the level goes above 10%, regenerate the desiccant in your oven at 110 degrees Celsius for 2 hours. Since we have seen that the carbon fiber reinforced nylon didn't seem to dry in the food dehydrator properly, I tossed that roll together with 3 more rolls of plain and carbon fiber reinforced nylon into my kitchen circulation oven. I used real 85 degrees Celsius instead of the 65 degrees Celsius of the food dehydrator to find out how much more moisture at higher temperatures can be removed and in what time frame. I opened the door in regular intervals to let the moist warm air out to improve drying. The results show that even though the spools were pre-dried, the elevated temperatures were able to remove significant additional amounts of moisture, and even after almost a whole day, I was still able to measure a small decrease. That lets me conclude that if you work with higher technical materials, it is necessary to find a proper drying solution and check the weight to see if the process finished. Even though I've successfully been using a food dehydrator for many of my materials, at least mine is not sufficient for some of the more demanding filaments. If you have questions about drying temperatures and times, also don't hesitate to contact the material manufacturers. So let's quickly summarize the results. The importance of dry 3D printing filament is too often overlooked. If you have problems printing a material, make sure it's sufficiently dry. Vacuum drying works, though it's not as efficient and effective as drying with heat. Adding desiccant to the vacuum chamber helps a little. A food dehydrator is sufficient for common materials like PLA, PETG and ABS, though struggles with higher demanding polymers. Weigh your materials regularly to determine when drying is finished, if you're in doubt. Storing materials with sufficient amounts of desiccant does not only keep common materials dry, but even removes some moisture. Storing materials in a vacuum chamber with desiccant is even suitable for highly demanding materials. All of these tests took me several months to finish, with lots of time involved running up and down in my house, turning on and off pumps, and weighing samples to gather all of the data points. Audible, who's today's sponsor of the video, is during work like that always in my pocket to keep me entertained and educated. Audible gives you access to an unbeatable selection of audiobooks, including bestsellers, mysteries, thrillers, memoirs, and more. I've been listening to Ready Player One on one of my last holidays, which is a story set in a dystopian world in the year 2045, where the protagonist is on an Easter egg hunt in a virtual reality world with lots of retro game and movie references of the 80s. After buying myself a virtual reality headset a couple of weeks ago, I realized that the virtual reality life that the whole world is living in Ready Player One might not be as far-fetched as I thought before. Forget the movie. But if you are interested in diving into that world, go and listen to it. It's really great. You can now listen to it totally free by visiting audible.com/CNCKitchen, or if you're in the US, by texting CNCKitchen to 500-500. Start your free Audible trial today and listen to, besides your monthly audiobook, to an unlimited number of exclusive Audible originals that aren't available anywhere else. No risk involved, and you can even keep all of your audiobooks forever if you, at some point, decide to cancel the service. So go and get your free audiobook at audible.com/CNCKitchen or by texting CNCKitchen to 500-500. Thank you, Audible, for sponsoring this episode. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you're all doing well. If you found this video helpful, then leave a like. Share it with the community and make sure that you subscribe for more. If you want to support my work, head over to Patreon, become a YouTube member, or use the affiliate links in the description. Go check out my other videos if you currently have more time than usual and want to educate yourself. Stay healthy, auf Wiedersehen, and I hope to see you in the next one.